Shakespeare said, I always feel happy. You know why? Because I don't expect anything from anyone. Expectations always hurt. Life is short. So love your life. Be happy and keep smiling. Just live for yourself, and before you speak, listen. Before you write, think. Before you spend, earn. Before you pray, forgive. Before you hurt, feel. Before you hate, love. Before you quit, try. Before you die, live. With this beautiful thought, a very good morning to all my dear students. I hope that you all are in good health. This is Shreya Jadhav welcoming you all to my e-learning channel. And today we are going to learn English, Grade 10, Chapter 7, Glimpses of India. In this chapter, we have three different parts to learn. First part is a baker from Goa. Second one is Kurg. Third part is tea from Assam. So today, in this video, we are going to learn the first and the second part of the chapter, a baker from Goa and Kurg. So now, let us know about the author. Lucas Rodriguez, born in 1816, died in 1973, was a great Konkani essayist. He wrote several articles in English and Konkani to various periodicals and magazines. He served as the visiting professor of folklore at many universities and also a professor of English in Mumbai and Goa. His essays were posthumously published under the title of Soil and Soul and Konkani Folk Tales. Subtle humor and informal narration are the essential features of his writings. Introduction for answers. Dear students, whenever you write down your answers for exam purpose, always keep in mind to start your answers with introduction. This creates a good impact. Prose. Prose name, a baker from Goa. Author's name, Lucio Rodriguez. Genre, short story. Summary. This is a pan portrait of a traditional Goan village baker who still has an important place in the society. What changes take place in the life of the baker with the passage of time? A glimpse of it is presented in this extract. So now let us go through the summary of the chapter. The people of Goa has been habituated to eating bread from the time of the Portuguese rule. The elders remember this. The Portuguese have gone, but the makers of the loaves with their mixtures and molders are still there with their age-old furnaces. One can still hear the thud of the traditional baker's bamboo in the morning, where the second generation still carries on the profession. They are known as pedder in Goa. The writer remembered that in his childhood, the friendly baker would come at least twice a day. The jingling thud of his bamboo would wake up the children, and they would get up and run to greet him. The children were not interested in the loaves, but only in the bread bangles or a special sweet bread. The bread basket would be placed on a vertical bamboo. The young children would be driven away, but they would climb the benches and railing to see what was in the basket. The narrator remembers the fragrance of loaves. The children didn't bother about brushing their teeth with a mango leaf toothbrush. They satisfied themselves with the thought that the tiger never brushed his teeth and the hot tea would wash and clean their teeth up nicely. Even today, the baker is important for every village. Marriage gifts are meaningless without sweet bread called bol. All parties and feasts would lose their charms without bread. For daughter's engagement, the lady of the house has to make sandwiches, cakes, and bolinas were a must for Christmas and other festivals. In the olden days, the baker or the bread seller had a peculiar dress called the kabai. It was a single piece long frock reaching the knees. In the narrator's childhood, he saw bakers wearing a shirt and trousers which were shorter than full-length ones and longer than half pants. People still joke that a person wearing a half pant below the knees is dressed like a peddler. The bread money was collected monthly and the accounts were written on the wall in pencil. Baking was a profitable business in the olden days. The baker's family never starved, but he and his workers looked happy, plump, and prosperous. Even today, a person with a jackfruit-like physical appearance is compared to a baker. So now, let us start the reading and explanation of part 1. A baker from Goa. This is a pen portrait of a traditional Goan village baker who still has an important place in the society. Our elders are often heard reminiscing nostalgically about those good and old Portuguese days, the Portuguese and their famous loaves of bread. Those eaters of loaves might have vanished, but the makers are still there. We still have amongst us the mixtures, the molders, and those who have baked the loaves. Those age-old, time-tested furnaces still exist. The fire in the furnaces has not yet been extinguished. The thud and the jingle of the traditional baker's bamboos hurdling his arrival in the morning can still be heard in some places. Maybe the father is not alive, but the son still carries on the family profession. These bakers are even today known as peddlers in Goa. So over here, it is always the writer is starting with an introduction that the people of Goa has always been habituated to eating bread from the time of the Portuguese rule, and the elder members remembers this thing. The Portuguese have gone, but the makers of the loaves with their mixtures and molders are still there with their age-old furnaces. And it has also been said that the old generation is not there, but the second generation still carries on this the profession. They are known as peddler in Goa. During our childhood in Goa, the baker used to be our friend, companion, and guide. He used to come at least twice a day. Once when he set out in the morning on his selling around, and then again when he returned after emptying his huge basket. The jingling thud of his bamboo woke us up from sleep, and we ran to meet and greet him. Why was it so? Was it for the love of the loaf? Not at all. The loaves were bought by some paskin or bastin, the maid servant of the house. We were longed for where those bread bangles which we chose carefully, sometimes it was a sweet bread of special make. The baker made his musical entry on the scene with the jung jung sound of his specially made bamboo staff. One hand supported the basket on his head and the other banged the bamboo on the ground. He would greet the lady of the house with good morning and then place his basket on a vertical bamboo. We kids would be pushed aside with a mild rebuke, and the loaves would be delivered to the servant. But we would not give up. We would climb a bench or a parapet and peep into the basket somehow. I can still recall the typical fragrance of those loaves. Loaves for elders and bangles for the children. Then we did not even care to brush our teeth or wash our mouths properly. And why should we? Who would take a trouble of plucking a mango leaf for a toothbrush? And why was it necessary at all? The tiger never brushed his teeth. Hot tea could wash and clean up everything so nicely after all. So now it was that the writer remembered that in his childhood the friendly baker would come at least twice a day. The jingling sound of his bamboo would wake up the children and they would get out to run and to greet him. The children were not interested in the loaves, but they were only interested in the bread bangles or the special sweet bread. Because elders were interested in loaves and children were only interested in sweet breads. The bread basket would be placed on a vertical bamboo, the young children would be driven away, but they would climb the benches and railing to see what was in the basket. The narrator remembers the fragrance of loaves. The children didn't bother about brushing their teeth with the mango leaf toothbrush. They satisfied themselves with the thought that the tiger never brushed his teeth, and the hot tea would wash and clean up their teeth nicely. Marriage gifts are meaningless without the sweet bread known as the bowl, just as a party or a feast loses its charm without bread. Not enough can be said to show how important a baker can be for a village. The lady of the house must prepare sandwiches on the occasion of her daughter's engagement. Cakes and bolognese are the must for Christmas as well as for other festivals. Thus, the presence of baker's furnaces in the village is absolutely essential. The baker or the bread seller of those days had a peculiar dress known as kabai. It was a single piece long frock reaching down to the knees. In our childhood, we saw bakers wearing a shirt and trousers which were shorter than full length ones and longer than half pants. Even today, anyone who wears a half pant which reaches just below the knees invites the comment that he is dressed like a peddler. The baker usually collected his bills at the end of the month. Monthly accounts used to be recorded on some wall in pencil. Baking was indeed a profitable profession in the old days. The baker and his family never starved. His family and his servants always looked happy and prosperous. Their plump physique was an open testimony to this. Even today, any person with a jackfruit-like physical appearance is easily compared to a baker. So now, usually what happened? That even today, the baker is really very important for every village in Goa. Marriage gifts are meaningless without a sweet bread called bowl. All parties and feasts would lose their charm without bread. For daughter's engagement, the lady of the house had to make sandwiches, cakes and bolinas were a must for Christmas and other festivals. In olden days, the baker or the bread seller had a peculiar dress called kabai. It was a single long piece frock reaching the knees. In the narrator's childhood, he saw bakers wearing shirt and trousers which were shorter than full length ones and longer than half pants. People still joke that a person wearing a half pant below the knees is dressed up like a peddler. The bread money was collected monthly and the accounts were written on the wall in pencil. Baking was a profitable business in olden days. The baker's family never starved, but he and his workers looked happy, plump, and prosperous. Even today, a person with a jackfruit-like physical appearance is compared to be a baker. So this is all about the explanation of chapter number 1 of unit 7, that is a baker from Goa. And now we shall go to the reading and explanation of chapter number 2. Chapter number 2. So let us know about the author. Lokesh Abrol or Dr. Lokesh Abrol is a doctor, traveler and social entrepreneur who loves India and likes writing about different places he visited in India. Coorg is in Karnataka and is famous for coffee, rainforest and spices. It lies geographically between Mysore and Mangalore. So now let us know about the summary. Coorg or Kodagu is the smallest district of Karnataka and is situated between Mysore and Mangalore. It is a beautiful heavenly place and resembles a kingdom of God. It has an evergreen forest with spices and coffee plantation. It covers 30% of the district. It rains heavily in monsoon. The best time to visit it is from September to March. There are coffee estates and colonial bungalows hidden under tree canopies. The people of Coorg are of Greek and Arabic descent. It is believed that a group of Alexander's soldiers settled here and married local women. Their culture is seen in the martial tradition and religious rites followed by the Coorgis. The men wear a long black coat called a kupi. It is like a called kufi worn by the Arabs and Kurds. The Coorgis are very hospitable people and have many stories of bravery. General Kariyappa, the first army chief, was a Coorgi. Even today, Kodavus are the only people in India who carry firearms without a license. The Coorg regiment is very respected in Indian Army for their bravery. The Kaveri River flows through the hills and the forests in Coorg. The Mahasir fish are found in abundance in this region. There are elephants, monkeys like macaques and langurs, squirrels, birds like the kingfisher, bees and butterflies near the river. The region offers people high ceremony, adventure with river rafting, canoeing, rappelling, rock climbing and mountain biking. There are many walking trails for trekkers. When one climbs the Brahmagiri hills, one gets a wide-ranging view of Coorg. A walk across the rope bridge brings one 64-acre island of Nishargadam, which is India's largest Buddhist monks Tibetan settlement. One can see them in robes of red, yellow and ochre color. Thus, Coorg helps one to discover the heart and soul of India. So this is all about the summary of the chapter. Now let us take the reading and explanation of the unit. Chapter 2. Coorg. Kurg is coffee country, famous for its rainforests and spices. Midway between Mysore and the coastal town of Mangalore sits a piece of heaven that must have drifted from the kingdom of God. This land of rolling hills is inhabited by a proud rare race of material men, beautiful women and wild creatures. Kurg or Kodagu, the smallest district of Karnataka, is home to evergreen rainforest, spices and coffee plantation. Evergreen rainforest covers 30% of this district. During the monsoons, it pours enough to keep many visitors away. The season of joy commences from September and continues till March. The weather is perfect with some showers thrown in for good measure. The air breathes of invigorating coffee. Coffee estates and colonial bungalows stand tucked under the tree canopies in prime corners. So over here the writer is telling that Kurg or Kodagu is the smallest district of Karnataka and is situated between Mysore and Mangalore. It is a beautiful heavenly place and resembles a kingdom of God. It has an evergreen forest with spices and coffee plantation. It covers 30% of the district. It rains heavily in the monsoon. The best time to visit it is from September to March. There are coffee estates and colonial bungalows hidden under tree canopies. The fiercely independent people of Kurg are possibly of Greek or Arabic descent. As one story goes, a part of Alexander's army moved south along the coast and settled here when Britain became impractical. These people married amongst the local and their culture is apparent in the martial tradition. Marriage and religious rites, which are distinct from the Hindu mainstream, the theory of Arab origin draws support from the long black coat with an embroidered waist belt worn by the Kodagus, known as kupi. It resembles the kufiya worn by the Arabs and the Kurds. Kurgis homes have a tradition of hospitality and they are more than willingly to recount numerous tales of valor related to their sons and fathers. The Kurg regiment is one of the most decorated in Indian Army, and the first chief of Indian Army, General Keriappa, was a Kurgi. Even now, Kodavus are the only people in India permitted to carry firearms without license. So the writer tries to say that people of Kurg are of Greek and Arabic descent. It is believed that a group of Alexander's soldiers settled here when it was impossible for them to move ahead and have married local women. Their culture is seen in the martial traditions and religious rites followed by the Kurgis. The men wear a long black coat called kupi. It is like a kufi worn by the Arabs and Kurds. The Kurgis are very hospitable people and have many stories of bravery. General Keriappa, the first army chief of Kurgi. Even today, Kodavus are the only people in India who carry firearms without a license. The river Kaveri obtains its water from the hills and forests of Kurg. Mahasir, a large freshwater fish, abound in these waters. Kingfishers dive for their catch, while squirrels and langurs drop partially eaten fruit from the mischiefs of enjoying splash and the rippling effects in the clear water. Elephants enjoy being bathed and scrubbed in the river by their mahouts. The most laid-back individual became converts to the life of high-energy adventure with river rafting, canoeing, rappelling, rock climbing, and mountain biking. Numerous walking trails in this region are famous with trekkers. Birds, bees, butterflies are there to give you a company. Macaws, Malabar squirrels, langurs, and slender loris keep a watch eye from the tree canopy. I do, however, prefer to step aside for the wild elephants. The climb to Brahmagiri Hills brings you into a panoramic view of the entire misty landscape of Coorg. A walk across the rope bridge leads to a 64-acre island of Nisargadama, running into a Buddhist monks from India's largest Tibetan settlement at nearby Bailakuppi is a bonus. The monks in red, ochre and yellow robes are amongst the many surprises that wait to be discovered by the visitors searching for the heart and the soul of India right here in the Coorg. So at the end, the writer is trying to tell us that Coorg Regiment is very respectable in Indian Army for their bravery. The Kaveri River flows through the hills and the forests in Coorg. The Mahasir fish are found in abundance in this region. There are elephants and monkeys like the macaws and langurs, squirrels, birds like kingfishers, bees and butterflies near the river. The region offers peoples high energy adventure with river rafting, canoeing, rappelling, rock climbing and mountain biking. There are many walking trails for trekkers. When one climbs the Brahmagiri Hills, one gets a wide panoramic ranging view of Coorg. A walk across the rope bridge brings one to 64-acre island of Nisargadama, which is India's largest Buddhist monks Tibetan settlement. One can see them in robes of red, yellow and ochre colors. Thus, Coorg helps one to discover the heart and soul of India. So this is all about the reading and explanation of Chapter 7, Glimpses of India, Part 1, A Baker from Goa, and Part 2, Coorg. So I hope that you all have understood the chapter. Thank you for watching and have a nice day. If you still find any doubt or difficulties, you can comment down in the comment section below. Have a great day, everyone.